So Lord Diltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin. Bicasdor son of Deutos, Julian son of Baineth, Peregrine son of Barbador, Andri daughter of Avrain, Senkit daughter of Youth, and the Ort son of Court, Paladins one and all. Heirs to legacies from blood and from deeper bonds. Having escaped the clutches of the Aztec snakes of fitness and racial purity, the Paladins enjoy their first peaceful rest since their disastrous attack on the war wagon. As the sun rises and they pack up camp, they realize a rather substantial problem. They're lost. Andri pulls out her map and tries to get a general idea of where they are. "Here's where we started the day we fought the orcs," she says, pointing to the extent of her charting. "We traveled about 15 miles before we encountered them, then ran until nightfall after that, but I don't know in what direction. Based on how the sun was setting and the shadow of that hill we set on fire, I think southwest is a decent guess," Julian said. "We were going full tilt for about 3 hours, so maybe as far as 90 miles, possibly closer to 70 since we don't ride as the dragon flies." "Right, that would have put us about here," Andri says, pointing to a white space in a small sea of white. "Then we went for the quarry." She traces her finger up slightly. "So we're probably somewhere in this general area. If the reports of the distance and size of Sand Jonas are correct, then if we travel northeast, we should reach it in 2 or 3 days depending on how passable the terrain is. Aye laddie, these hills are definitely going to slow us down, at least the rest though ye." Kasdor rumbles, "But considering what's on the path we may be cunning to take the wild roads, there's also the risks of monsters in the woods as well," Senkit advises. "But at least those probably won't be able to throw lightning bolts at us." She flinches involuntarily. "By the way Kaz, can you do anything about the gaping hole in the back of my armor? Nee, until we find more material, and probably a full-on forged tabled, there's just nee enough left of it to fix. Ye'll have to endure the breeze for a wee bit more. Considering the way your old armor worked, I'm surprised you're concerned about a lack of coverage, from a protection or a modesty standpoint," Julian jokes. "My armor was meant to work in a land where winter is about as hot as your summers and summer is like standing inside a blast furnace. But even then it still covered all the important places, and my back is an area I'd like to keep daggers and arrows free from." The Chultun Tifling responds, "Enough you two, we'll fix it when we can. For now, let's get moving," Andri says as she rolls up her map and blows a sharp whistle. Moments later, her stagpang canters out of the woods up to her. She strokes his side, happy to see him again. Julian's hair goes flying over his face as Warpig snorts into existence behind him and trundles over to Kaz, who gives the big pig a hug. "That is the most affectionate I have ever seen anyone act towards a giant pile of bacon," Julian comments dryly as he mounts up on Bucephalus. "You've never seen a halfling harvest festival then," Peregrine responds as he hops on his mighty steed, who is currently chasing his tail around in circles. Reunited with their mounts, the party rides northwest for the city of Zahn Jonas. They make good time, but grow increasingly concerned as dark clouds cover the sun as they approach. By midday, it has begun to pour rain down on the party, wind lashing the mountainsides and lightning crashing through the heavens and striking the treetops. With such fury visited upon them, even the stubborn Kasdor admits that they should probably find shelter until the thunderstorm passes. Within a few minutes of searching, the party finds a cave in the hillside to shelter in. Somewhat more wary after their encounters with the Jumti, the first thing the sopping paladins do is search the cave out in its entirety. Fortunately for them, this small cave is unoccupied, save for a great many bats who are startled by the party's torches and swarm out squeaking into the storm. After Kasdor cleanses the cave with a roaring blast of dragonfire, the party takes rest, drying out their equipment and lighting a small fire while they wait for the storm to blow over. Warpig flops down in a corner, making a warm wall to lean against. Bucephalus grazes on the grasses near the entrance next to Pan. Merry, Peregrine's hound, tries to get the Igonadon to play with it, but the big reptile simply curls up to sleep. Sankit sets out a rain catcher so that they can refill their water skins, while Julian pulls out his spellbook and conjures warm loaves for the party to eat while they wait, then lingers on the front of the book, where the picture of his mother is. "I never got around to until now, but thank you all for stopping to help me get this back. It means more than I can say," he says as he shuts the book. "It's near great thing, Arken, how important family heirlooms can be," Kazdor responds as he sharpens his axes. "It was your mother's, wasn't it?" Julian nods. "The only one of hers I was able to get, and the only half-finished one to boot. You've mentioned your mother several times. What was she like?" Peregrine asks, ever curious. "More than that, you grew up in Sigil, the City of Doors. There's got to be some interesting stories there." Julian smiles faintly. "There certainly were. My mother was a genius woman, a former adventurer who set up shop in Sigil a few years before she had me. She was quite the conjurer and a fair hand with illusions too. I think the picture I have is the only one in existence of what she really looked like. She'd use a different face for everyone who walked in our door. She settled down compared to how she used to be. I still remember a couple of times where an old member of her party would walk in and they'd talk about some madcap quest they'd gone on. Stealing secrets from the Fae, fighting off Jianqi on board a spelljammer, the amount of trouble she got into was legendary." He chuckles. "Since I got here, I found out some bard or another got a hold of her story and made it into a song, Baneth the Doppelganger I think. Got most things wrong like bards are prone to. Of course, she'd settled down, but that just meant she was randomly off in another plane getting ingredients only about once a month instead of every other day. She'd set up a shop of sorts, selling spells and potions to anyone who would buy. We got all the sorts, mudrons, girth. I distinctly remember there was an adventurer at one point who wanted a gate spell linked to the bottom of the ocean. Strange fellow that one." "So was that how she met your father?" Peregrine asks. "No, I don't actually know how that happened. She'd always laugh and tell me I'd learn when I was older, and he won't tell me either. He sounds almost embarrassed by it. If I had to guess, I'd say it probably involved no small amount of trickery, and I was more an unintended consequence than anything else." Eyebrows are raised around the fire at that statement, and with how casually he stated it. "I think I can see where you got your casual attitude towards the gods," Sankit responds. "No doubt, Mother was not exactly the reverent type. She treated everyone as they were, whether it was an angel sent to pick up a package or a pit fiend having trouble getting his wings through the door. That would have been funny if he wasn't so terrifying. She bowed to nobody and didn't condemn anyone either. Her two rules were no fighting in the store and no demons," Julian says, and it's clear how his mother's irreverent courage impressed him. "And the crazy thing was, nobody ever dared break that rule. Of course they'd beat the nine hells out of each other outside, but no one started anything in the shop. So why'd you decide to come here then and not just stay in Sigil?" Peregrine questions, and then regrets it as he sees Julian's face sour. "Something of hers caught up with her and broke the one rule. I still don't know who or what, but there were arrows the size of lances in the ruins, still glowing white hot. I took what little I could salvage and left. Sigil is not a pleasant place to stay unless you are remarkably powerful, or have someone like that backing you up." He concludes his story on that bitter note. "Quite the tale." Sankit asks, "What of your father, Aximund? Just your average self-righteous champion of justice who thinks raw power is enough to make him the ultimate arbiter of morality and mortal behavior. Mildly surprised he hasn't tried to declare himself a god by this point," Julian says dismissively, but Senkit's eyebrows shoot up. "Wait, did you say Aximund? As in, yes, that Aximund, the great and mighty fool who was tricked by some random witch into siring a bastard?" Julian interrupts with a jackal's grin. "A shame that never got into the stories, he'd never live it down. Maybe I should try to have it added sometime." The angel's son looks at Senkit with a slight glare. "Interesting that you know him, Ms. Zarathustra," he says, placing special emphasis on her surname. "I've been told I have his eyes. I suspect you have your father's tail and horns." Senkit visibly glows with anger, then cools. "I suppose neither of us are our father's children. I know, we must be such disappointments." Kazdor looks from one to the other in their continued glare off and sighs. "I think it may be a wee blessing that our dinny ken me blood parents. You never did. There's a tale there." Peregrine says, endeavoring to maneuver the subject away from something that's going to end in an all-out brawl between Senkit and Julian. Kazdor picks up on this and continues. Ah wee laddie, there's one there indeed. Long afore I was even an egg there was a great dragon laird called Zenariven. Single quote he was a right skinner that won, and rallied an army of kobolds and dragonborn to his side. The dwarf king, Dutos Glamdring, raised the throngs to take furious vengeance upon the drake for his many trespasses against the Doi. It was a fell and furious battle, raging up and down and inside the great mountain caves that Zenariven called Issaman Fortress. There the king's Skonkborn son, Kazdor, fell in battle, and was found surrounded by the bodies of his foes, the axes Oaklangadin still held in his grasp. At last, the battle was ended when King Dutos slew the dragon with a mighty throw of his hammer, Orcbreaker, and cast the drake's body down the mountainside. When the battle was done, single quote he came upon the Doi warriors smashing the eggs o' the fled dragonborn and kobolds, and he fell upon them in a great rage. There are lines tena be crossed, even in ending a grudge, and slaying babies is one o' those lines. Single quote he took an egg, and said, this is my grudge fulfilled, a son for a son, and he shall be called Kazdor. And one o' the Doi there asked, my laird, what if it's a girl? And single quote he answered, I'm, then she shall be called Kazdor, ye great fool. It's a fine name for a lad o' lass. The others chuckle slightly, and Kazdor glowers at them. Well it is, he declares. Wait, so you're a prince? Senkit asks. Nee exactly lassie, ah, and third o' me father's sons, and can he inherit anything even if I were the firstborn? The long beards would know of it, they nearly didn't have it altogether when I was first brought back. My father single quote a de many a long argument with them, and kept having them even after I was hatched, and even after I had joined the priesthood and became a servant o' the gods. Sis part o' the reason I left, so my father would nee have to deal with the schooners and their constant bitching. So how did you and your father get along? Andre asks. We did well, single quote he was always at but fair, wouldn't tolerate anyone saying anything untrue about me, including myself. The amount o' times he yelled at me to get me head on straight and quit listening to fools was enough that if I had ears they'd have fallen off, he says with a laugh and smiles. He cared for me though, and they treated me as though I was just a replacement for the real Kazdor, even though I am. What about your older brother? Kaz grimaces. Teke and I was nee the real Kazdor and they forgot it. Aside from being a century my senior, Dee and I never got along. Tina forgave me the grudge o' his brother dying, and I can nee blame him. At the same time, I can nee forgive him the grudge o' how his jealousy and foolishness kept Alf the old against me and a quarter against my father. Dee was half as strong as me, nee as keen a fighter, and I could match him in everything but it was nae enough for the skinner. He snarls. Between I'm and the long beards, the greatest gift my father gave me was the order to set forth and use my axes to end the grudges against our people wherever I might find them. Even if I was sad to leave I'm and what few mates I had behind, it was for the best, he says with a sigh. Op that letter I sent I makes it. What about yourself then, Peregrine? I've spilled my story, so ye best at least return the favor, he asks the halfling. Oh, me. Well, there's a lot of stories going on there, I'm not as young as I look, the halfling smiles, slightly sadly. There's a lot of mess I got myself into and a lot I got myself out of, mostly on account of my accursed fancy feet, he says, plopping out his large and hairy feet in front of him, near the fire. You see, the Horsey Rider family has a proud history of getting ourselves into trouble. Ever since our founder took Horsey Rider saved the village by stealing a horse and inventing the sport of golf, but that's a tale for another time. Mostly though, we had settled down and mellowed out, contenting ourselves with a humble life of making excellent pipes, he says as he produces his own pipe, an expertly carved wooden piece in the shape of a dragon's head. We have very clever fingers and hands, and so we took to carving well, but I was a shade different. Maybe it was because of the stars I was born under, or maybe it was because I was simply told one too many stories about great heroes and fantastic duelists, winning the hearts of ladies, fame, and fortune through skill at arms and charming wit. But regardless of why, I wanted to be an adventurer. Of course, like most children, I had no idea what being an adventurer actually meant. It mostly means sitting in caves like this waiting for storms to blow over so you can go and kill more people before they kill you. But when I was young it all seemed so glorious. So, in the afternoons I would spend my time studying fencing and swordplay, using the very old swords that my family had but hadn't used since old took. It was all going so very well until one day, when I got into a quarrel. It was over such a simple thing that I've actually forgotten about it, but I was wearing my sword so I... He stops. I killed poor Samuel. I never meant to, but I had been thinking of fighting and killing and swords so wrongly that they'd become toys really. I didn't realize what it actually meant, killing someone, how easy it is. So I ran. I took the swords and I ran from shame and from fear. I hadn't meant to, but I'd killed a friend. I thought that I surely had to be a bad sort, a wicked sort because I'd done it. And, well, when do you think you're a wicked sort and run away from anyone who will help you, you wind up a truly wicked sort. For a while I really was. I went bandit, and became really rather good at killing people. Nobody ever expects the halfling, the little fellow to be the dangerous one. I was sick of it from the first time I started, but I figured that since I was clearly a wicked murderer this was all I could do. I bought the lie that because I had made that one mistake I was wicked, and always would be. So I made mistake after mistake and heaped wickedness on top of myself and dug a hole so deep I could never get out on my own. But I wasn't on my own. The old priest from my village found out where I was, I don't know how, but he found out. By that point I really was well and truly evil. I had my own little band of cutthroats and we almost killed him before I realized what we were doing. I don't know how, but he still believed in me. He still thought I could be something better than I was right then and be someone better than the foolish child who treated swords like toys. So, I went back with him. The others tried to stop me, but I was a far better fighter than all of them at that point, and the priest was too. In fact, he was such an incredible fighter that even all of us now working together probably still would have lost. It was after that fight that I realized this wasn't the old priest. He smiled at me and vanished, and in my hands, the old swords I'd been using had a new pair of hilts. Peregrine holds up his short swords, the bone hilts glinting ivory in the firelight. I went back. I made amends, and they forgave me. Unbelievable, after everything I did they still forgave me and believed in me. I couldn't stay though. So I headed out from there, and wandered northwards until eventually I happened upon the caravan heading north. Peregrine finishes, and then lights his pipe. And that is why we don't give up on people, you never know what the gods have in store for some scoundrel bandit. The storm blows and the paladins wait, thinking on each other and the strange circumstances that led them all together. Be me, Paladin. Be Castor, Undri, Julian, Senkit, Peregrine, and Eort, paladins who I can't be bothered to add titles to this time. After the Baxtree inciting storm blows over in the morning, the paladins set out just as dawn is breaking over the hills. They ride hard all day to make up for lost time, and with Undri leading them through game trails and a few lucky rolls, they make extremely good progress. As the sun begins to set, the party crests one last hill, rounds one last bend, and looks down on the remains of a once magnificent city. San Jonas. It sprawls across the whole of a river valley on both sides of a great river, even spilling out onto the lower parts of the surrounding hills. This is a truly massive city, easily as large as Great Baldur's Gate or Waterdeep, surrounded by old yet still sturdy looking dwarven walls. The main road runs into it through a great gate from the south, and leaves in the north. The great river, easily 4 or 5 times the breadth of the one in the south, runs through its center, spanned by several great bridges. Even from this distance the paladins can hear the sound of waters rushing. Even in ruin, the city retains some small echo of its magnificence. In the southeastern corner, a grove of trees, unusually tall and broad, still hold the remnants of an elven quarter. An aged palace stands in the center, likely once the center of government for the city and perhaps the entire area. Not far from it, the spires of a magnificent cathedral, still unfinished, scrape the sky. Not far, a tall circular building rises, built in the style of southern libraries and universities. In her prime, this city must have been the envy and the jewel of the north, but now lies tarnished by time and war. Indeed, while these great monuments remain, Much of the city is nothing but black ashes, remnants of fires that once swept across it. Heaps of rubble and crumbling shells of homes outnumber the houses still standing, and across it the evidence of a half dozen different savage races lie like blisters on the realm. Here there lies the remnants of what was once a mighty goblin camp, now a den for scavengers. There the orcs have torn down the rubble and formed it into a great den in the shape of an ever-watching eye, branding their foul god's symbol into the land such that even the heavens may see it and retch. The black vines grow openly from an ancient mausoleum, unafraid even in the dying light of day, thick like ropes binding the land. Paths of destruction lead to an old gorging field as the abyssal spawn desecrate the once great park in the southwest, near the Elven Glades, a great pillar set up to honor their foul father. The paladins look upon this and each grinds their teeth and clenches fist and talon around their weapons. Kazdor sees the symbol of Grumshan vows destruction. Julian sees the university in shambles and curses the chaos that led to such a loss of knowledge. Peregrine sees the Noel camp and his eyes glint dangerously in the twilight. Senkit sees the vines and her horns alight with hellfire meant to cleanse and burn. Yort sees the camp of his people cast down, and his stomach twists with the painful memories of the last time he was here. Undri sees something else though. She sees the Elven Glade, and marvels that it remains unmolested, despite the ravages the rest of the city has suffered. She looks at the trees and the dwellings there waiting invitingly, and knows that there is something wicked hiding there, though she knows not what. We are going to need an army to retake this. Julian hisses as he looks on. Even if we could purge the city, it's simply too massive for even the whole of the colonists, the goblins, and halflings to hold even if our numbers were tripled. He says as he realizes the enormity of their task. We can e-rally an army while the blight still lingers. This will need be happy nine for years at least. Today, we gather information, find out where the Eld Dwarf hold and the halfling realms and the elf city was. We'll deal with that issue, then in time, come back and settle things here. Right, Julian says as his prodigious mind begins to immediately go to work, but he shakes his head and focuses on the task at hand. We'll camp here tonight and figure out our targets. Undri, can your elf eyes see well enough to make us a map? Yes, but this place is complicated enough I'd probably need a day or two to complete it assuming I was working non-stop. Even then it wouldn't necessarily be perfectly accurate. I'd need to be on the ground to get a proper idea of scale and street layout. Undri responds as she gets out a fresh sheet of parchment and her tools. Get what you can tonight. An outline is still better than nothing. Julian orders as he and the rest of the party handle setting up the camp. Undri nods and gets to work getting what little she can done in the last hour or two before night falls, and darkness deepens beyond her ability to see. Down to infrasight, that's all I'm getting until the morning. She reports as she packs up her tools and heads back into the center of camp. Using a large flat stone for a table, she spreads out the crude map. It shows the outline of the city, major landmarks like the cathedral, city hall, and the university, and the largest streets, but the majority of the map is still white space. Considering our objective is getting information, I propose we start at the university, here. Julian says, pointing to the large tower. If we enter by the main gate and then circumnavigate the Noel camp, we'll be very close. We should also check the city hall, here in the center. The university isn't far from the high street, so we could potentially take that. Senkit advises. Bad idea, far too open, far too likely to be heavily traveled. We should probably avoid any and all main streets and entrances, enter over the walls and travel by alleyways and sewers to avoid contact with any major organized groups, Undri advises. Then pick off outlying scout parties and raids whenever possible to weaken them. Guerrilla tactics and thieves' paths. Kazdor rumbles. Strange tricks coincide there and what we usually do. Thieves' paths, that's a great idea, Kaz. Peregrine says excitedly. Any city this size must have had a guild, and if it was a successful one it definitely had a series of hidden paths and secret hideaways. Could be an excellent way to find rest stops and shortcuts, assuming the marks are still there. Wait, you speak thieves' cant? Eort and that both ask suspiciously. Speak, no. But I did learn some of their symbols, namely the ones marking out good places to hide, Peregrine admits. Alternatively, The Elven Glade seems to be mostly devoid of orc or gnoll incursion, Andri mentions, and it's a potential source of information on where to find Fi Karan as well. If you're going there, I'm staying back, Yort warns, especially after night. That place is more haunted and cursed than any place I've ever been, and that includes the Shadow Abbey. The ghosts in there killed entire Decanon with one shriek. Banshees then, Andri says. Then I most certainly have to go there. Her amethyst eyes harden and the moonbow on her back seems to glow. I cannot allow them to remain entrapped in this coil. Also, on the topic of places we need to go, we should at the very least investigate the cathedral for potential restoration and reconsecration, Senkit advises. It is near the city hall, and so heading there would not be too far out of our way. Considering what showed up last time we consecrated something, I'd advise we not spend the night there if we do consecrate it, Julian advises. And while we're at it, we should avoid the graveyard like the plague with how many blight tendrils are there. If I had to guess, that's probably where the original rent was torn that started all this nonsense. Right then, so we sneak in o'er the walls, take back ways to the university, slip from there to the ul and the cathedral, and leave by the Elven Quarter. Kazdor says, tracing the route, this is probably gonna take a day or three, especially if we mean to clear the whole old university. We can clear the whole thing when we come back, Julian says. Our primary concerns will be their library to recover any useful spells or history books, their armory to recover any magical items still left behind, and their registrar's office to track the location of other major settlements. Once we get to the city hall, our primary target should be the post, Peregrine advises. Tax offices too. They're not exactly valuable, so they're probably still there. But we can cross-reference them with the registrar's work and the dates between packages to find a general idea of where other settlements could be. We should also keep an eye on the actual letters if we find any. We might find a clue as to more specific locations there, Andri advises. The cathedral might also have correspondence we could use to locate other holy sites to restore. A good idea. What are we after in the Elven Quarter then? Julian asks. Information about where to find Fi Karan, but our primary objective is any sort of major shrine to sell Hayden Moonbow. If I can find one, I might be able to use its power as a focus to put the Banshees to rest. If I recall correctly, isn't Selhaden the goddess who governs passage between life and death? Senkit asks curiously. Yes, that's why her altar could be useful to open the way for the ghosts. Wouldn't that mean it's probably in the middle of the graveyard of evil blight vines? No, we prefer to cremate our dead and scatter them in natural areas so that their bodies cannot be disturbed by necromancers and the like. That Aang being buried underground doesn't exactly make a whole lot of sense when you're coming back. Elven snobbishness is actually useful for once. By me be it, Ardna thought I'd see the day. Kazdor jokes. We're both learning things. I was mildly amazed at just what a magnificent footstool's doing make after I started traveling with you. We are going to need your help to get over the wall, Andri responds, but the pair's sparing is more good-natured than anything else. Your pronunciation is terrible, Kaz rumbles. All right, you two get some rest, Peregrine says before this degrades into an insult off. Between you two and the other two, I'm getting a headache from all the lovers' quarrels going on around me. It's like I'm a side character in a Shakespeare play. The paladins look at him, and then at each other, and break down laughing. When Kanya melts, Julian snorts as he heads off to bed. Andri smiles slightly, and then it fades like she tasted something bitter and she goes off without a word. Kaz raises an eyebrow, or at least where an eyebrow would be if he had hair, and heads off to bed. Lover's quarrel, that's a good one. He snorts as he beds down. Senkita's first watch and spends a large portion of it glaring at the chortling halfling with enough force that she starts to vaguely remind him of a beholder, which causes him to chortle all the harder before eventually slipping off to bed. Bah, halflings, she mutters as she returns to her watch. As the day dawns, the party eats a quick meal and moves on towards the city. Somewhat unusually, they're engaging in stealth missions during the daytime, as the majority of their potential foes are nocturnal. They approach the wall near the Gnoll encampment, betting on the idea that the Gnolls will be the least likely to set sentries to watch for them. That bet pays off, and the party once again forms a human ladder to get up over them. We are getting remarkably good at this trick, Peregrine says as he summits the wall and looks around. He can see the main party of gnolls lazing about on the green, and a few stragglers wandering around the edges, but the coast seems mostly clear. You're not getting any lighter though. Kaz grumbles from the bottom of the pile, glaring up at the halfling and then snapping his head back down. As the party tosses down a rope to haul the big dragonborn up, Andri responds. Neither are you. With the party now atop the high walls, they soon lower a rope down the other side and climb down as quietly as a bunch of paladins, several in full plate armor, possibly can. All is going fairly well until, in a stroke of bad fortune, the rope snaps while Julian is falling down. The party winces as they wait for the loud crash, but by a much better turn of fortune, Julian has landed in a remarkably soft and noise-dampening pile of garbage. Not willing to break silence just to rib the uptight Asima, the party gets moving along the streets, ducking behind back alleyways and checking their corners before moving on. They're making progress, but it's slow. Peregrine peeks one corner to see a large number of drunken gnolls stumbling this way, and motions for the party to get clear. Ducking inside the ruins of an old house, they manage to stay unnoticed by the inebriated creatures, who are busy playing hot potato with what looks like a large angry mouth with legs as they walk, laughing like the hyenas they keep for pets. More demon, Julian whispers, not a good sign. Gnolls don't usually have demons at their beck unless they're doing particularly well. These things must be ludicrously strong then, that demon's nearly their size and they're tossing it around like a ball. Senkit hisses, impressed in spite of her hatred for the creatures. Not really, from what I remember more demons weigh pretty much nothing, they're just mobile mouths leading directly into the hyena lord's gut. Julian responds, actually quite happy to be lecturing on the ravening monstrosity getting ever closer to their hiding position. As the gnolls pass by, the already snarling ball of nasty grows even more irritated, scrambling around in the air before breaking free and launching itself howling at the wall, which it scrambles up before diving with a bloodthirsty howl down at the paladins, and they apparently have a really good sense of smell. Damn. Julian says as he draws his sword and strikes the ball of teeth and bad temper across the ruined house. Although split nearly in two, it begins a yipping howl, which soon the drunken gnolls hear and pick up, and soon that is echoed by a lot, and I do mean a lot more gnolls. I think the best strategy here may be to retreat, Kazdor says, and the party listens. If even the battle-loving dragonborn says it's time to run, it's really time to start running. As such, they run for it, Andri finishing off the more demon with a well-placed arrow as they retreat. Before long, they hear the thunder of a thousand very angry and remarkably hungry gnolls pounding down the flagstones after them. At their head is a creature like a massive albino hyena with a scorpion tail, accompanied by a particularly large and angry-looking gnoll, Shuozva. This is very not good, Julian says as they duck and weave through several alleyways, with the gnolls slowly beginning to gain on them. We need to loose these things, and our scent with it all that thing will track us to the ends of the earth. Our scent, huh? I've got an idea. Peregrine says as he pulls up a manhole cover. Without time to worry about hygiene, the paladins jump in, Senkit bringing up the rear and dropping the manhole closed behind her. The paladins land in the foul-smelling shallow water of the sewers, wade the walkway by the wall, and catch their breath, but only for a moment as they see the manhole cover start to move. They didn't have quite enough of a lead. The party briefly considers making a stand. Here in the sewers, the enemy can only come at them a few at a time. But with their enemy's sheer numbers and potential to flank them, they decide to continue the retreat, hot-footing it down the sewers, taking turn after turn hopping to loose the baying abyspawn. Peregrine scans the walls as they run and finally spots a certain symbol. I knew they'd have secret rooms down here, he says with a grin as he leaps up and presses in the stone with the symbol on it. The brick slides back, and a hidden door slides open. The paladins all duck inside and shut the door behind them before the gnolls can spot them, and sigh in relief. It is then that they notice that this former thief's den is not unoccupied. Small spears and shields line the walls, cots sized for children sit inside, and a long dark tunnel, clearly freshly made and meant for someone Peregrine's size, has been dug into a nearby wall. From that tunnel, several pairs of yellow reptilian eyes stare at the party with curiosity and no small amount of fear, and the party stares back.